man named Dan Babber honored his mother by posting an auction on eBay, and this auction was entitled Best Mother in the World. And the winning bidder in this auction would receive an email from his mom, Sue. And Babber promised, and this is a quote, that if you receive this email, it will make you feel like you're the most special person on earth. How did people respond to Dan's offer to receive an email from his mother? Well, during the auction's 7-day run, almost 43,000 people looked at it. It's enough to fill most baseball stadiums. And 92 people bid on this email, pushing it from a $1 opening bid to a winning bid of $610. 92 people bid to receive a stranger's email just because they wanted to feel loved. Someone was willing to pay over $600 so they could get a loving word from a total stranger. Wow. This story is interesting because it shows us how desperate people are to pay for something that God is offering as a lavish gift. This morning we're going to look at a very beloved passage in the Bible, a passage that describes God's love in all of its tenderness and its extravagance. If you're a Christian, that is, if you have asked Jesus to forgive your sin, and if you're committed to following him as your Lord, then 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 is a verse that you need to know well. I'd go far as to say that it's a verse that we should all have memorized. This is what it says. How great is the love that the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. This morning we are going to look at what this generous love of God does for us and to us. I want to begin by saying, as much as I use and love the New International Version of the Bible, in this passage, as the Apostle John is telling us about this wonderful love of God, the New International Version loses some of the power in the words that John is communicating, because John begins by this verse with a command, and the New International Version drops that command, and it starts, "How great is the love the Father has lavished on us." But that phrase, "how great," is in the command form, and so it should be translated more, "behold," or "look at." Look at how great the love that God has for us. See how great the love the Father has for us. It's a command to examine it. This command to behold or see, John is calling us to pay attention to it, to meditate on it, to be amazed at this love that God has for us. And of course, as most of you know, the Greek word that John uses for God's love for us is not the word for passionate love. It's not the word for family love. It's not the word for friendship love. It's a higher love than all of those loves. It's the word agape, which is a loving kindness, a sacrificial love. This is the only kind of love that, this is the only word that John uses to describe God's love for us. This is the kind of love that motivated God to send Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, and this is the kind of love that he shares with you and me. In telling us about this agape love that God has for us as Christians, the Apostle John says, "How great is this agape love, this unconditional love?" And that phrase, "how great," describes something that's foreign, something from a foreign country, something that you're not used to or familiar with. It's exotic. It's unlike anything we've ever seen before. The kind of love that we're used to is a conditional love. If you love me, I'll love you. But if you quit loving me, then I'll probably quit loving you. That's the kind of love that we're used to. But this love that John is talking about here is foreign to that experience. It's a love that loves us no matter what we do or what we don't do. God just continues to love us. No matter what mistakes we've made, what sins we've committed, how long we've walked away from God, He doesn't stop loving us. And this phrase, "how great," also carries with it the implication of astonishment, of amazement. It's almost as John is commanding us, he's also gasping at this amazing love. My paraphrase of this verse: take a look with admiration at this astonishing love that God has for believers. On January 27th of 2005, there was a Los Angeles commuter train that wrecked. It was a terrible wreck. It killed 11 individuals and injured scores. There was a first responder there, a firefighter named Captain Rosario. And he says that he's worked a lot of accidents, seen a lot of injuries and a lot of death, but this is one that he says he'll never forget. And that's because after they had extracted all the victims that they thought that there were, some passengers said, no, there was a man trapped even deeper down in the debris. And they took the jaws of life and they worked and they got down to the bottom of the wreck. And there they found a man named John who had been pinned in the wreckage. And while he was pinned in that wreckage, this man named John was having trouble breathing and he thought he was going to die. And so as he was bleeding, he had nothing to communicate with. He sought to communicate a message to his family. And so with his own blood, he wrote on the seat in front of him, "I heart my wife, I heart my kids." And when the captain saw that, he was overcome. And as he was being interviewed by the TV cameras later, he was choked with emotion as he thought about this man in his dying actions communicating in his own blood how much he loved his family. Well, in a similar way, of course, God communicates his love, the depth of his love for the world, with the blood of his son. God's message of love to us was shown in Jesus' blood on the cross. You see, the Apostle John says that this astonishing, this otherworldly love that God has for us is so great that God wanted to take us who were his enemies and make us his children. To take us from being enemies to being children. And the only way to do that was to sacrifice, a perfect sacrifice. So Jesus died in our place. When I was in junior high, I had a friend. His name was Jim O'Brien, and we were best friends. We were really good buddies. We called each other brothers. We would often say that we were closer to each other than brothers. And on most weekends, either I was at his house or more often than not, he was at my house. And he would call my mom, his second mom. We were very close. But Jim wasn't really my brother. And my mom was not really his mom. Those were just titles that we used, ways to communicate. But the Apostle John is telling us in this passage that when we ask Jesus to become our Savior, that we become God's children. The passage says, "How great is the love that the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." And that is what we are. This is not a cute title that we get to call ourselves children of God, even though we're really not. The language there communicates that this is a new reality that we experience and that we live in. God's love is so great and so measureless for us that he actually makes us his children.